artist will be walking around mm-hmm. with you, filming you, and will be the person teaching you, asking you questions of clarification, things like that.
Okay.
If that's okay with you.
Part of your body is already being dead.
Intake of what you have with your opponent. So this, these 10 things, when you get down right, and you know what you're doing, and when you're exposed with these 10 things, even if you throw two blocks, just because you're moving, and your blocks are so fast, and you didn't throw a punch, you still stay in that same position. You don't come out of that position. Once you get into that position, you stay in that position. And when you stay in that position, the next movement becomes so simple. But if you make another move, and then you're trying to guess what the opponent is going to do next. It doesn't matter what kind of opposition you have. As long as you do your techniques, the defense techniques, explosively and with meaning of the techniques, then you have a concept for yourself. You are performing what you know the best. But when you get led into his concept, just like sparring, if he leads you, then you're guessing all the time. Which becomes a committing or sparring that's very, as I put it, not scientific at all, not enjoyable. It's a losing game every move that you make, because you're making it because you have to make it. But if you make the decisive move first, and the concept of technique is proper, then it's karate. That's why you do a lot of these techniques over and over and over, until it becomes helpful to you because your movement is there because you have to make it. Or you make the movement to make the opponent make the movement. Then karate is enjoyable. But until then, karate is not enjoyable, or sparring is not enjoyable, until you find that concept. And you've got good teachers here. You've got very good teachers here under Sensei Lampo, and I know this. And you have a lot of many good black belts in the organization that will help you. And that makes a good instructor too, that makes a good black belt. It's not whether he just teaches black belts, which I do just teach black belts. But I find I learn more by teaching more belts too. And this is really true. This is the concept that I talked on in Japan. And I found that they would ask me questions of who do you prefer teaching, what kind of classes do you prefer teaching, high intellectual classes from the universities or the labor group or the maintenance group or whatever. This is the way they categorize it in Japan. And I find that it's just a mixture of students and ranks is what counts. It isn't the background or anything like that. The white belt, young kids, I taught them all. And I don't step out of line and say that I prefer teaching just black belt because it's so much easier to teach black belts. It's not enough. As a matter of fact, black belts are very hard to teach because they all have different concepts of themselves. And they've all really finalized their future body movement, which is very hard to turn back. But the young ones, the beginners, is very hard to steer, and very easy to steer and teach karate because they are accepting everything that you give and you correct them fast. But here in Alberta, in Edmonton especially, I think I've never been but across Canada in the USA, the concept of learning the proper way is really high class. And when I come here, I often debate to myself and think, well, I've never prepared anything for today's workout or the next one, and I never do. I always find that today, you know, I was talking to Sensei Neil, and he said, Kabaddi techniques, you know, they prefer a lot of Kabaddi techniques that Sensei Ben has suggested to ask for me. And I said, that's a really easy concept for me, because in karate, I mean, I just lived this far. That was my whole life in karate. I hated cuts. I like techniques, but I hated cuts, and I love sparring. But in order to get to my position, you've got to be able to do cuts, just as good as any sparring endeavor that I have. I have to be good at everything. Not just to show people that I am good, or wow people, but it's that at all. It's just that I have to do it so I feel good about it. And I have to be sincere and honest. Whenever I do a technique, I do it explosively and fast, because that's the only way I know and what I've worked to. I'm not here to just show people up or show black belts up. I mean, those days, my thing was showing anybody up. That was 40 years ago. And at my age, I just want to teach the truth of what I've learned, what I want to preach, and the way of thinking in karate, as well as how to develop your mind. And the only way you do it is sincere and honest. And that's, whether it's karate or football or hockey or politics, that's the whole issue, is be sincere. So you're, within yourself, you have a concept real, clean, youthful, healthy way of thinking. And with that concept, you learn karate just like that. It isn't, a lot of people say, well, that's common sense, education concept. It's not karate concept. It is. To get true meaning of what karate is all about is the meaning of building yourself to be good person, character-wise, good thinking. So you're healthy with everything that you do, everything that you see, everything that you think has got to be clean. And when you do that, you've got everything to gain and nothing to lose. So that's what you do, you put that into karate. And that concept, when you do it physically, when you set up at University of Tennessee, the concept that you're trying to focus is you've got to learn this, you've got to get your grades. That's a good concept, but you're not doing it physically. It's just your pencil. You're not moving your body, you're not raising your legs, you're not jumping around, moving around. So now this concept in karate, while you're moving around, you still have this clean concept. And that's what stays in your mind. No matter where you go, what kind of work you do, if you're walking or running or whatever, swimming or whatever, the concept stays with you. You're not just sitting there and bringing it in. So, Otsuka Sensei has always told me that. And I used to think, I don't want to know that. Because I just found that I worked hard in my life, and I don't want to know all that. I just want to learn karate. That's the foundation of karate that you've got to have. All the other is a waste of time until you get that true concept. When you get that true concept, the karate becomes so dwelled in you that there's no way that you can lose it. It's there to stay. Then it helps you with your life, with your family, whatever. And this is what I want is you accept it with an open mind, use it with your body, feel good about it, because you're doing the right thing. And once you know that, once you're told this, and you practice these ideas, and the concept of the true output that you put into it, invisibly becomes you're scared of this opponent or not. If you do it, you aspire the same way, you move in, and you do this same technique where your knees are up in the front or back, just rushing in. If you do that technique, you set the opponent right up. It doesn't mean that when you do this technique standing here like this, that you have to do it always this way. You have your walking movement this way. You have all kinds of different ways you can use it, adapt, and you start squaring. But you use this technique moving into the opponent. And when you use this technique, it's a combination of gathering technique that you're offensively using to your opponent. And he is subject to following right into the keys of what you're working. The techniques that you're working, because he has to. Because that's the way he visualizes it coming. So if the opponent is coming with a front kick, as soon as that front kick is made, you know what you have to do. But if you move back on the front kick, then you have to start all over. So what I'm going to teach you in these sessions here while I'm in Edmonton is making sure that no one steps back. Because when you step back, it's not correct. That's what you see in the open circuit. People are bouncing all over the place and back and forth. And you can do that all day and get tired. But if you get to my age, you fall down and exhaust. That's all techniques that you don't need. So when you're young, sure you can have extra energy, so you can dance around and it might not hinder you. For myself, I'd be lucky to walk to the park if I jumped around a lot of young people. So I've stored up so much karate technique that I don't have to move. You just stand there, whatever technique comes. You just combine it into your offensive move. So anything that's offensive, I gather it and go right into my offensive technique. This is what I want to teach in this world. Okay, everybody? Okay, so now what I want you to do is go left leg forward. Now you should always practice both sides. But I don't want to work both sides today. You can teach yourself. If you do enough singles, you can teach yourself the other side. Okay, so I want you to get your left leg forward. And you're just going to do left leg forward. You might be left-handed and you'll say, well, I can't work the other side. I would wish to this side. Go ahead and use your other side. See if you're left-handed or right-handed. Any side that you want to use, go ahead and stand the way you want to stand for sparring. Okay, now I want you to do the same technique, but just bring your knees up and you do the block here in the principles. So it's 1, 2, 3, knee up. Do it on your own time. Make sure that your standing knee is always bent.
Okay, almost do it. Do those double blocks like your right defender. Keep your head up. Don't drop your head down. Keep your head up and do those double blocks. So the punches are coming at your face just as fast as they can come. So you're saving your life. Okay? You gotta think of those things. Then you put everything in. Okay? Same side, or you want to use the other side, that's all right. But I think you have to really work this technique, kind of you're quite safe in saying that it'll work for you. Now, make sure that the knee is up. You must get your knee up. Now, when you're spinning here, your knee is coming up. See this one? And from here, drive away. So you get that tricky. So you're catching your opponent, see? One sees like this because of the double block. And then you have to keep them this way. So then you bounce with your knee up with your tippy forward to give them the chances. So that way he's back on it, see? So once you have them step back, once you have your opponent, you have your technique within the opponent, you have to keep them on that knee. That's a knee. Now, it's like this. When he comes into me, I do a double block. stop, sir, because I marked these two punches. See? And from here, I go. So once I have him in that field, see that? I have to, see? Drive him in the distance in order to keep his body to a point where his technique is not ready to go. So when you have that concept on the corner, then it's scientific. So that's what I want you to do, is do your double walk here, and the knee up, you'll protect it, go forward this way, but not this way. Keep your head up, keep that distance of that chicken. Okay? Everybody? Keep that concept. And when you're practicing, you're going to walk down a little bit. Look straight forward, keep your back straight, the head up. And if you want to keep your back straight and head up, you have a better balance. Walk your leg, that's okay. Get the leg up again. And try to get with the count. So if you lose your balance a little bit, that's all right. I'm trying to stabilize your balance. So when you've been there, then you know how to double yourself. Eight. That's it. Keep your knee bent. The standing knee must be bent. Your back straight. And make sure those double blocks are blocking your face. It's not much use blocking way down here. So make sure they're blocking your face. That'll give you that extra power of the kick, the thrust. Don't lose it. If you straighten your leg up like this, slow down, there's no way that you're going to get a good kickoff. It's got to be bent and get past thrusts. Okay? Bitch! 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 Good. I want to keep your back straight. That'll win you points and counts, too. But it's positive. That's the only way. Scientifically, your body can be strong and sound in the back and beautiful technique from it. Eight. Eight. Good. Eight. Eight. Good. Technique. Now, I won't make a count on the third count that we reach me. You'd be like, just like we're doing right now, itch, new. And I won't count the third one, the sun. You just make your front snap and when you're ready to throw. Make sure that your standing leg is bent. Don't straighten out and throw a kick. Keep it bent and then kick off. And when you're finishing that kick, you can straighten that up. That'll give you extra power. And we'll do that with the same stance that you are. And then we'll do a little longer. You can work the other side if you want, the higher belts. The lower belts just work the same side so you can collect what you're doing. Okay, everybody else? Okay, two count, people. Okay, and the third count is on your own time. Do a front snap kick, whether it's weak or strong, it doesn't matter. The main thing is getting the idea of throwing a front snap kick. And that front snap kick doesn't go to the head, it just goes to the belt or to the groin. Okay? Okay. You gotta see that important now, people. You're looking straight ahead, going sideways. Not on the floor, straight ahead, the thumb is the same size. Okay? Visualize the two punches coming to your head. I just found that There were very few Japanese or Orientals of my age that get on the floor and teach. And I think myself that you've lost something when you don't go on the floor and teach. When you're on the floor teaching, you're living Gujarati. You can speak in Gujarati, sure. But it's so, you know, away from the real thing. And what I'm preaching now is the psychic meaning of karate techniques. When you do with body movement, you're deeper in concept. It's like when I was trying to talk in terms of sitting and learning or doing books or doing your exams. The concept of moving your body and learning this exercise, this sport, is something that you can learn forever. Football, hockey, baseball, you have your whole dimension of the game already. Everybody knows what the limit is. But in karate and concept, there's so much. There's no limit to it. I can teach forever. And I can teach. I just found in Japan now I can teach ranking people, higher ranking people, has been doing lots of karate all their life, and they still do the down drive, the jodan again, the wooden again. And this is the way they fight in the world tournaments. The concept is wooden again,
basic techniques that I'm teaching.
used to be Spartan. You never see this concept in Japan at all. Concept in Japan is Ube Getsu. You know what I'm This is the concept in Japan. You always see this concept. I don't care what style you're in, Hongo, Shotokai, Nembukai, Wanokai, it doesn't matter. This is it. Tsuki Kamune. So when I throw this here, he's going to get me here. No, Tsuki. See, that's why he threw the Nukes. Okay? And the concept that Neil showed is that's a new song. That was a bad concept. The kick is in. That's the concept. That sounds like the concept. Is Tsuki? No, no. Tsuki, yeah, yeah. See? That's the concept that everybody does. Tsuki here again. Jodan Ki. Tsuki here. That's the concept. Now I'm doing the same thing. So when it goes the other way, he throws the reverse one to my head. I go do the smash me in the face while I'm trying to get him here. That's, see the concept that they want? They're still going to the world championship. And you wonder why people from all over the world, and Japanese too, broken noses, broken teeth, and you say, why? And they say, well, they're reckless. It's not that at all. They're trying to work speed with speed. But you're going to get caught. But the idea of this is here. You throw it to here. See? When he throws that one, comes there. And then, that's the concept that I'm trying to teach. Why, when his tuki is coming, how am I going to meet him while his technique is already left? Because his concept is tuki to tuki. See? Mine is a block. After this tune, because it's a secondary block, see? It's a block here, and I'm trying to beat him low with that tune. Where that was his concept. But see, here, that's my concept, see? And he doesn't expect that. That's what I'm teaching. See, people? That concept, that punch block, is the one that's going to beat you. Because from there, you can do all kinds of things. It's like this. So you come here, sweep. It's so easy. It's open. It's an open karate concept. And this is so simple, but you have to work on it, people. Forget about your leg techniques way up in the air. Forget about jumping around doing wheel kicks. I used to teach that 35, 40 years ago. I could still do it, but what for? It's ridiculous. Do you see the concept in the world championship? To be the best in the world, you stand there, lock on, it's right here. Front kick here. Unless you're fighting 50 people. So what you have to do is, the technique is in front. Everything that your human body, as long as you're a human being, two legs, two hands, everything's in front. And you work it that way. Sister Joseph. Say. He's a little tall. Say I'm down here. Now, I'm not going to come here. So it took me way up there. Why should I run here? I can get him without him even seeing what's happening. This is not a scientific concept, but it is science where the power is. See, people? It'd be ridiculous for me to fight my way up here when I have no concept of stability here. So I lose my concept. So I'm giving myself to Joseph because of his height and power. But if I'm fighting down here, he doesn't know what's going on. So that's what you've got to do. Thank you, Joseph. Okay, everybody up? Okay, now. Okay, we're doing just a few more. The higher belts, you can change your sides, alternate if you want. And I want you to get this concept, know what you're doing, see? Right from a standstill. If your life depended on it, it could be a grab from your home, it could be a one-hand grab, it doesn't matter. You do that double bar fast, okay? But when I say hajime, do your three movements with good balance. If it takes a little more time to balance yourself with a good kick, don't throw any flicky bad kick. Make sure that when you throw a kick, it means something. And if it doesn't mean anything, you're just hurting your leg. You're going to hurt your leg, you might get, you get all kinds of twisted nerve, pinched nerve, Charlie horse, you can call that anything. And you'll get all that if you don't mean to kick when you should kick. If you just let it go, you're not doing good to your knees anyway. So when you kick, everything has to go. Ball the foot, kick, snap it in and out. Ready? Kick! Okay, everybody ready? Go to the people that stands. Go to people that stands. Let's bring it up. Just shuffle slow, see? Shuffle this way. Throw a double punch. Shuffle this way. Throw a punch. Okay. Go to the left first. Double punch. Right first. Right. Double punch. To the right side first. Hitch! Knee! Sun! Chin! Hitch! Knee! Sun! Chin! Hitch! Knee! Sun! Chin! They're doing it with a natural stance this time. They're shuffling with the left foot, squeeze, shuffle, squeeze. Go to the right foot. You don't have to shuffle too much, you know. Just 9 inches, you know, 9 inches one way, 9 inches the other. 9 inches to the right first. Hit! Very small shuffle. Just almost like a toe kick. Straight movement, just on step and shuffle. So one shuffle. So, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. So you went, you got to feel almost like you went there, but you don't stay there. Move out of it.
Thank you. she both feet and kept finding the floor all the time. So you're here.
Well,
here.
Not always, no.
Your heels might,
you can lift that.
As a matter of fact, when your heels come up, it's better for kicking. It's a little more ready. The kick is more ready. See, yeah, the concept, and I don't say this to the world, that's because it might, that's the concept. Of Japan.
Oh, yeah.
You
okay.
Always make fun. It's not true.
Mm-hmm.
When you kick, them, your heel should come off for that extra thrust.
Yeah.
It's just like the pitcher. When you throw it right here, that goes for torque.
Yeah.
There's no sense of torque in here.
Yeah.
You probably last 3 feet.
Yeah.
And your distance is tight.
Yeah.
When you bench it, you can't do it. Don't throw it from here. Throw it off the here.
Step through and you finish it.
Yeah, that's what they call your finish. A lot of people don't think, they think that as long as you step here and get a nice looking finish, that's a good finish. It's not so. The concept of throwing a fast pitch is stepping as deep as you can, gaining ground. That's why it's called 50 minutes.
Yeah.
Throwing it off of this leg.
Right.
When you throw off this leg, you make the batter closer to you.
Yeah.
So you're really cheating on the batter. So that's the concept.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And maybe you don't have it.
Yeah.
You know why I made good playing ball? It's because I have that concept.
Yeah.
So, what I'm told, from a little bit.
Yeah, from like, because you take the extra step.
Lord, I mean, it goes, oh, God, you know. But the thing is, I'm over there when what we're pitching from here.
Uh-huh.
But I'm pitching from here.
Yeah.
So I always, and I wind up, I'm not as tall as tall. But when I move forward, my stance is here, depends on what I'm saying. So when I come off, my movement is all there. The speed, they don't know that I'm so
counting from the front foot. So that's the same in kata, when you come in here.
That's right.
That's the
right.
That's the punch
that's
doesn't
the
come from here.
Yeah, but who does that?
Yeah, the punch just comes from.
Okay. Who does that?
Yeah.
Unless you do the chickies, you know?
Yeah.
Constantly. I thought when I got a lot of time, I'm going to teach that to some of the
baseball pitchers. So in fighting, of course, you're never going to step through because it takes too long.
That's right.
So you get the last, you get that from there.
That's right.
From there.
Because you know, tell you the truth, without that extra hip movement, that kick's not going to be anything.
Yeah.
I mean, if you were to want to hurt.
Yeah. I have one other question, Sensei. When you were doing that shuffle, you were going heel toe, heel toe. Then when you do it real fast,
just toe.
It's just
it is heel toe.
Oh, it's in.
It's, but you don't do too much of it,
yeah? Yeah.
You just do a gesture.
Oh, I see. Just
yeah,
for the...
That's right. The concept of the one person, you see?
Yeah. So it's just enough to get you some Tai Sabaki
right,
to get out of the motion, or out of the direction. Okay.
see there the white tour of the center. It's a blank of the tongue composure. And give yourself time to really don't try to fool anybody right now. And we'll be so sweet. Do a lot. When you either side, alternate if you like, because you all come out to the outside. So you should be able to alternate techniques. So he throws a left punch, he throws a right punch, it's a block here. He throws a left punch, right punch. This is all I want you to do. Get this technique down so it can be so fast. So if you're blocked, if you can't block it, so move your head back slightly. Try to get those techniques. Get it down so it can be so exposed. Because the white belt will throw fast punches, please. Fast kicks. So I want people inside to watch the higher belt, move their blocks, and try to win it when you get on the outside. Okay.
Now, am I throwing up this way, or do I adjust it so that it's lower? So it's always relative to me, not necessarily to the person.
That's right.
Okay, I see. And again, the view that you want to take away the legs, but also the upper body as well? Okay.
Yeah, you want to go with the strength for your benefit, and speed for your benefit. So if I was real tall and you were short, and you start going from here,
up here,
then you're wide open for those kicks, you see?
So what you're saying is that you're using the same fighting style regardless of the opponent. You're using your fighting style for yourself, from yourself.
For yourself. For yourself, the target for yourself only. Picture, photographing it to the opponent.
Okay.
Your own power, your own size, your own height and technique. That's why they say, you know, when you teach, when you learn karate, you do everything with your own height. Never mind the people shorter or taller. Everything that is going to be to your benefit, scientifically, is you're fighting your opponent to your own height. See, that's why you take a kickboxer, little shit Japanese guy comes up to big kickboxer, he's fighting guys, trying to kick his head off.
Yeah, just
which is so stupid, you know? And all this big guy has a real bone in his stomach and he's finished. And they can't wonder why. So they think the head is more vulnerable, but it is, you know? The thing is, if you're a short person, you fight everybody, that's where you're going to do the most damage. And the place that you can go the fastest, and that's the height that you can protect yourself to. So,
his fists are coming down at our head like this. So we can't block like this anymore. We have to block like this.
No, you don't block at all.
What do you do?
You know, you just move. Like, you know, he throws a punch, you know, he's coming down.
Yeah, he's coming down here.
Yeah. So it's on the...
I really want to use this.
You just have to shift, don't you? Shift points. So that's what you got to start thinking of doing.
And same thing with a great big...
I got you. Just sweeping hands, moving.
So just, yeah. Just
I'm throwing
what you were just teaching.
I'm going like this.
Yeah, because what's the only thing that when you're fighting Joseph, you got him to be able to move in when he's wide stance.
Yeah.
That's when you
move. I'm throwing this block.
When he's like this, you don't move. Really when he's on wide stance like this, you can move in fast.
Now, when you're fighting a really, like a great big beefy person, you know, what they do is they're locomotive. They just come in. Okay, sorry.
Okay, next fighter, Paul Flores.
Yes, you were saying?
So, you're fighting a great big guy. I don't know.
Great.
What they tend to do is they don't care what you throw. They just come in, boom, 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 boom. Yeah. And you have to.
The best thing to fight a big, strong, heavy guy is just front snap kicks. It's the only way to fight. Don't fight him with hands unless he throws a hand. He throws a hand, you block and counter. Look, make it look like you're gonna throw hand kick here.
Then you go in afterwards with the hands after that, or do you back up again?
Fight him with kick.
And then just kick again. I thought that maybe I was just doing something wrong.
You could move in, and then, keep moving them around in front of kick. Or even fake a kick, the thing is, I found that if he's a strong, good fighter, I found that you can move in on your opponent, keep moving in on your opponent, as soon as he throws a technique, get him with a kick.
Yeah.
But you have to make that distance on the pace.
Yeah.
You can't move around like this a long distance for his opponent.
Oh, okay.
You gotta keep it tight for him so he'll throw something, but you're ready to throw a kick. But you're like a bird, Close, you're pecking away, but just as soon as you throw a bait, and then boom.
So you're trying to draw a technique out of him?
Yeah.
So you're fighting, in a sense, a counterattack fight?
That's right.
When he's disadvantaged, use his technique against him and then drive.
It's a front kick or a mawashi.
So you wouldn't necessarily initiate an attack against a person unless they were really in a weak position?
Defensive against you're counterattacking, but you're making them think that you are fighting offensive.
Well, so if you saw that he had a weak position, you'd attack with
him.
Then
I change my stance, then I come in, and then if he throws a hand technique, mawashi right away, or a front kick.
I have one more question. If somebody like Sensei Rempel throws a lot of hook punches, techniques that aren't necessarily linear, but hook around. Okay, how would you handle a technique like that? So if I'm coming in like this, so you're going to instantly move to the kicks low.
Yep. Anybody that's got long hands, you see my shoulder, blade techniques.
Watch him here.
Otherwise, you got to get inside. You don't want to get inside all day. It's showing your opponent that you're going to fight with your hand. As soon as the hand does come, you can throw power to the leg.
Okay. So, quite often, like a big person like Sensei Rempel has very long arms. So, for me to get my kick, like a mawashi, in close enough means to use the striking arm to his arms.
Well, if you're going to throw a mawashi to the front here,
or Megazuki.
Well, no, even a mawashi to here, his tsuki, you would be. Because he commits himself with his hands. So when he, even with the forward hand, if he commits himself here, and you dip back, then you're already from the match. Oh, so your hips are going to be touched. So that's where you're going to think.
And that's even on these sort of.
So if he throws a reverse tiki, this is about his thing to hear. If he throws a reverse punch here, what if it was you don't have to block anything, you just have to throw the mawashi. So you got to think in those terms. A reverse punch, mawashi. So you're about here, you're ready to fight me. And I come to your head goes back the same time as throwing the mawashi.
Now, if I'm blocked, or if he's moving fast enough to cramp my kick, I'm finished. Am I not? Because he's got momentum carrying forward. Would I be driven back? And aren't I guilty of bending like
this?
So it's a matter of speed. His,
if he jumps in that fast,
I'm caught here.
Right away, you go for the weakness, and then fall back until the sickness becomes cool. So you've got to get something to action.
While you're throwing me in. Okay, I see. So rather than just doing a walk, you start to drive both?
We could do both, yeah. But that, the main source of defense, when you have to make that defense, see, when Joseph comes in, boom, he comes in here.
I just want to try the block.
When he comes in, this man goes up here, this, already he can't score over this. He's finished. So what you have to do is score over this, and he goes back this way. That's when you can score. See, so what this, he moves in with the, that kind of a technique. It's not useful for him. But, you know, he's got to come in. You can this. Well, he wants this, you see? From there, I'm done. So if I'm there, if I come in like this, and if I'm in this way, that way, you know, the technique will go out. That's different, you see? So you have to.
Oh, sorry.
Don't work, you're going to have a lot of these things. Well, I will write out the I practice this.
Shift? Or better to stay still?
I think we can hire about just stay still.
Okay. Yeah.
But with the lower, still at the edge, you know? Because, you know, you get the lower yellow belt and try to jump.
Try to drive through.
Through the, yeah. So it's more to their benefit.
Yeah.
But still, it works, you know?
Yeah.
It'll work if you do it fast. No matter whether it's the inside block and the back, it doesn't matter. As long as you do it fast, it'll work.
Yeah.
You know, when I was in Japan, it was really strange. I was telling Joseph since he told me. I had two water students with me, Gerald Skyler. They were so boisterous, trying to tell everybody and trying to let me listen and hear that they left Gerald Scott again. I didn't want to hear it at all, but it just kept saying, but at the end, the last day, they told me that there was a lot of Wado students under Gerald Scott that would be at the next workout that I
had. Is that right? I thought they were finished with the All Japan Karate Do.
Well, they kicked out of the Japan Karate Federation.
Yeah.
Jiro Otsuka and his
wife. Yeah.
But if they leave Jiro Otsuka,
then they can come in.
Yeah. So I don't know whether I want those kind of people or not. But in Japan, if they have a reasoning and they state what the reason is that they left Jiro Otsuka, then you're supposed to accept it. That's what they tell you. That's not what I'm there for. Huh? I'm not there to criticize a Jewish student. I'm there to just teach them, and that's it. The Japanese people, all the university, the ranking people that play the university and the world championship are fifth downs and sixth downs. And these guys are just eating it up. It's another new light, you know, like the block punch right away. It's a new light of fighting.
Mm-hmm.
They don't do that, you know. I can't understand why, because it's so dangerous just to fight block punches. You know, this is the way Toto Kai, Gojo, Chico, even Wado, you know, in Japan, fight the same way.
Mm-hmm.
But you see, Otsuka Sensei said to me, first time I met Sensei, he said to me, you've done a lot of fighting. And I said, yes. I said, I've done a lot of open fights. I fought kickboxers. I fought everybody. I thought I was fighting sport karate. But, you know, they were able to get your head, kick your head right in. The Japanese were the worst people. Huh? So I said, I was fighting sport karate, but they weren't. And that's why I learned. That's why I had to survive. So that's why I learned to fight this way. I fought Golden Glove boxing fellows. I had an Al Galafola, you know, from Wellington. He was a Golden Glove champion in Canada. reason why I do bones. This is going way back now. He's about 55 years old. I used to fight him and fight him and fight him. Like, you know, block anything that he threw. He was fast. Mm-hmm. And we had gloves on, imagine. But still, I just forget. I've got the best against me. The kickboxers, you know how they do, you know? But you know, if a kickboxer uses light pads, straight karate punches, he'll drop anybody in his kickboxer. But they come in with those little hooks and all this sort of thing, pretty good, you know? I mean, it's so easy to block a hook.
Throwing Uryuki, then it's a bad technique, unless you throw Uryuki shift kick or something. But this changes, as soon as you add something on to that Uryuki, that changes everything. So you can use that anytime.
Oh yeah.
So just as long as you throw that punch block after.
As long as you do a block, coming right away.
Then you can throw Uryuki.
You've got to control this ball.
Okay.
You've got to control his body offense, right? You've gotta give that a little jolt so that offensive body movement is dissuaded or it's stopped or it's hindered. Then you have this
control.
I find that even in real life, well, I'll tell you, I've learned the real hard way. But you know, I think the reason why I had to make my techniques really hard is when I would block a punch, I'd drive that weakness right into the military, you know, make him hurt. Mm-hmm. And that way I stopped him, then I'd come in and score a good punch. If I just went boom, boom, you know, and just came in with a reverse punch, he'd be coming in with a triple punch.
Yeah. So you said this punch block is more like it's a peer, but it's more like a reeking with
when I had to fight.
Yeah,
that was in the late 40s.
Yeah,
that's a little different. See, today you would, you know, more or less do a punch block.
You punch and drive in with your punch.
Yeah, so that way.
And so you just take them off balance.
Yeah, that's right. You just off balance.
Yeah. But if it was for real, it would be boom.
Oh yeah.
And then fall in.
That's right. It's like if you're standing this way, you would just make a move and then punch. There's no sense of bringing this back and then punch here. Bang and then bang right away.
Right.
It's better to get him before he can adjust. That's if you work proper muscles, you know?
Yeah.
How to key up and throw a negative technique.
Yeah.
That's how you can get a lot of help with the law enforcement. We had about 3 weeks ago, we had a big bust in Hamilton, and there's a lot of young gangs that were in this the cocaine bust. Anyway, you know, we were gathering up all the loose meat, they call them.
Yeah.
Geez, a lot of the cops got hurt. So I told them from now on, there's no one, not one officer is going to get hurt. So this is the way we're going to take them out. And I showed them what we're going to do. We're ready for anything. We're gonna, the next bus that ever comes, whether in Toronto or Oshawa or Hamilton, Niagara Falls or Gatineau, we're gonna set it up so nobody gets hurt. We're not going that stuff anymore. We're just doing this one policeman. his knee is finished him, because the guy had steel boots, you know, steel legs on the front, cut right in there. His knee is finished.
Yeah.
It was the knee of they just sheared it right off. Kicked him so hard, and it was just the way the policeman was walking, dropping his foot at the same time. He just sheared it right off. Could use either inside or outside. The main thing is different facts. If you do a fact, I'll just tell them with a left punch, if you just used to this way, just use that first block and just drive that in fast.
It doesn't matter if it's inside or out.
As long as you get it down fast.
Inside, it's always a danger of him being at both of you being open.
That's right. Yeah, but I would just
but
think
the speed will compensate.
You have 2 feet here, and you right away.
Yes.
Before that one, you're right. So even when you're sparring, that's good. Because you'll stop that time there. Because you've got to sweep the laser over and let it sweep.
Understood.
So it works as long as you do that. For your advantage. But I think when you do the black belt work, that's what you want to do for it. It's
going to be good. Yeah, it's kind of fun.
In the opening to Kushenku, what we do is exactly the same thing, right?
Yeah.
But so in actual fact, the opening to Kushenku, or whenever we do this technique, there should be no pump. Like it's not.
No, I know what you mean.
It's not like that. It's.
Well, then Kushenku, or any cutting.
Yeah.
You've got to have the exact movement.
Oh, okay.
It has to be there. And the faster you do it, the harder you do it. That's the essence of the cut.
But we don't pump back here when we're fighting to go here.
Yeah.
We just go here, here.
You don't do this.
Yeah.
I've seen that before. Even in Japan, you know, it's 1, 2 here. They try to get this fast. The thing is, they snap everything. Like, you know, they do a little thing, they hit for something. And when I went there, and I knew that 80% was bad oxy. So I said to myself, I'm going to work my techniques on the wax. So I thought, what I'm going to do is work the stances. Work the shuto, the shoto fan, the shiro, ishinryu shuto, and then I'm going to work the wado shuto. So I did all the shuto every style, even the gojo shuto. Showed them how to get there fast, hard. Speed alone, I told them, is no good. It's got to be hard. Fast, explosive. So, I mean, what else can you teach? So, I'm hitting their territory, their techniques, what they lack. And boy, does everybody lack on Gedan Burai, Uri Uke, Soto Uke, Jora Uke. No matter what rank they are, they all lack. When it comes to tsukis, they all like to make that little. You know what they're doing? Jiro Otsuka-san, Tetsuo Otsuka-san, he is throwing right up here. His black belt is throwing tsuki.
Oh
my God, I was telling Joseph, I said, you know, Joseph, I'm going to give you a reel. Let's say Jiro Otsuka's teaching. He's walking around. He's calling, bitch, Okay, next, everybody. It's your next partner. And you walk it from him doing this. And then at the end, he's head like this. His teeth were like this. And he's walking around. And so one black belt comes up. Is it from here, you know? He was shown, and he had four or five black belts.
Huh?
You know what? Sensei Kato Suzuki was the same thing. No, I'll tell you, boy. If you did some real hard fighting, if you ever throw a teacher like that, you get somebody to throw a punch or a block or an elbow block, you're good. But it has to spiral. It doesn't matter. When it is, your tiki is ready. That's why it has to work out with court school. Mm. It doesn't like a work like court school. You get caught here, you get caught here, you get caught here, you get caught all over. When you work at a court, there's no way that they can hurt you.
It's the only way you can.
You'll hurt your opponent, yeah. It's the only way. And if you're going to rest it anyway, there's no sense of resting on the hip. There's no sense of belt. It's got to be where your weakest part is before the wind. So protect it there, because from there it goes far. And Otsuka Sensei said to me, there's only one way of tuki, and it's a proper way. It's got to go like a corkscrew. The only way it rests, kamae means rest for stability of the body. And that's the weakest part of your body. And you've got to rest it right there. So if the guy throws a punch or kick, at least you're protecting your opponent there. So when you put it there and you tighten up, everything tightens right up. But if you hold it way up here, you kick down here. As a matter of fact, you tighten here, you weaken it there more.
Shifting. He can't. He's got such long arms. And he's so powerful. He can't see when he's out. He doesn't even touch me.
Yeah. You see, the first block is not strong enough.
Yeah.
This black guy. The first block is not hard and fast enough.
Yeah.
You gotta really snap that first block. See, his first block is not just hardly there. Oh, he's concentrating on his second block.
Yeah, the second block.
The white belt, he was pretty solid, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to show you a little different, okay,
yeah.
The white belt. So I don't want, you don't want to bust him up and say to the black belt, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah.
Just let him go. If you don't have that, you don't shock.
Yeah.
Thank you. 1958, I was running tournaments. So it'd be about 1952, 53. There was a lot of people from Holland coming over. John Van Wen, Harry Hoosman, John Van Wen. Geez, I forget some of those names. That's been years ago. Peter Persma, I think it was Persma. Something like that. Piersma. Anyway, these are three guys I started with to become black belt, and they were all Canadian champions. They beat everything. And no matter where they went, they were champions. Hard, hard fighters. I used Jan Van Ryn because he was a big guy. And John, I told Joseph about him. He's a deacon in the church, you know, the church reform. They're all people from Holland.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, I went looking for him about 2 months ago. I had a little spare time, so I couldn't find him. So then when he heard that I was looking for him, he came looking for me. So we went and had a dinner and talked of the other days. See, the church reform that they believe in, they believe so strong that they don't believe in vicious movements. And that's why he had to have propaganda. Because it was like, he said, sure, you can block and counter. But he said, when you start fighting, and you start fighting even in your dojo, you become offensive too, you know? He said, that's a no-no. Okay, everybody change again. But I've learned so much. I've become a better fighter. After, you know, all the world competition that I went to, I had to learn to fight real karate. But thinking the sport karate, what they had the best in Japan, not even knowing how they react or how they fight. From the first fight on, I just kept learning. And I used to keep the story of the worst, dirty, and the sneakiest fighters. There was one from Japan. I kept it from North America. I never talked about it. But in the last 5-6 years, I've been quite boisterous about it. And the reason why is I'm living a second generation of thoughts in Japan. So now I'm teaching them. It's really strange. Okay, change again. Okay, change and start right away. You don't do it all the time, but it's good to have the higher belts get to know the lower belts and let the lower belts know that black belts aren't here just to look dangerous to you people. Mm-hmm. They can help you learn from them. It makes it sort of a together somehow. Like, you know, you go to a lot of these open clubs, you get the black belts come in there just to use the lower belts, kick them around and punch them around, and let the students know that you got to be strong there. They use them for dummies. No. That's the way they used to teach all over Canada and the United States.
It's all stand.
want you people to not start shifting. This way. So you're not doing anything. You're not throwing any technique. The bad ipon there is the Swiss. They're throwing away. See? That is not ipon. See? That is, what he's trying to do is aim upon. So it's not a little throwing blow. That's what I want you to go on. See? The world of the competitions, so you're really watching that. So I don't want you to block anything. Just try to move your head, move your body, sink a little bit, sink back if you have to. Make sure that you don't, you sink back, but I want you to do this. Get your knee up, sink back. Make sure there's a protection there at all times. Okay? Just keep going. You can change sides when you get tired, but the one side does not do anything. Things aren't happening. You're not registered anymore. So everything is different all the time. Every movement is different. That's what I want you to explore. You have to find it. You have to set it up. So this alone is clear. Those are definite moves. Not, no matter what happens, you're in. On your opponent, you have to have rhythm. When your opponent is advancing on you, who is a strong, heavy, hard opponent, you have to have rhythm to receive them. And we'll work that later. Right now, what I want you to do is here, aspire distance. You'll never get this close. If you get this close and they're as soon as you make this, you'll have the rhythm. See, it's from here, this is. That is the end point. See? So from here, you have to break that 1 feet. Once you make that 1 feet, you better know what you're doing. Yeah, you know? The distance is worth fighting. was your commitment. So when you're this distance here, and you don't know, you're right, you're already in there. So look at his move. See his move right there? You have him right there. But when you set that up, you can't make your moves. Okay. I want you to practice that and really find it to your benefit. When the hand comes up or the body goes back, the head goes back, you have to say. Using scientific movement to accent your ability of Mawashigiri or Maigiri. If it's Maigiri, you're a Maigiri person. As soon as you thrust that front kick, you have, your body has to arch right in, go fast, and in. You cannot just throw a front kick and move back. Most of the time, you're not going to score. Unless you catch him coming in with a tuki, and then you have stepped back and then going to mid-wash into a front snap kick. So a snap kick, that movement of your form coming in, a snap kick, and then a good point. A lunge kick at that time, it would be disallowed. You, all you're doing is just smothering him because he's coming in. So the only time that you would use a lunge kick is when you're chasing him to the outer limb. And you think that he's going to step out, just as he's going to step out, and one foot is up, and you are the only one that's going to be coming for a point, that's when he's going to lunge kick. Not any time. And you can fight that fight. You can fight that fight on your opponent. So when you get on the gym floor, and you have collision, make sure that you have some sort of a line that you and your partner understands, even if it's a door to work. And work with the lines. And just about one step out, catch him with one. You always, whatever he throws into the counter, it's not scoring. It's your opponent counts if you're in the way. That's the only time that you use a lunge kick, maybe kikomi, to your opponent and commit it. Not when the person is moving in, you're trying to, maigiri kiari, yes, snap it, not kikomi, thrust. So These are simple things. You know, even the best in the world. When they get on the floor, everything is not rigid. Because they have not practiced 1 or 2 hours. To be anything, be a professional. And being in the multi-world competition, and karate is not a professional you're looking for, and yet you have to be a professional person. No terminology or square exists and use it to your advantage. Especially if you're a person that's really fast with hands, you want to finish him off with legs, that's what you do. You find that he's close to the edge, you rush in with a mighty throw, a front kick, lunge. So these are the things that you have to really get to know. Really know that you walk karate, you practice karate, this is automatic. You think of those things. And that's what they experience today. It's the people that have used these techniques, not thinking, but even almost the last resort, in life and death, trying to hold existence of yourself in that tournament. And then you fight 17, 18, and then you go 27 fights in the semifinals. You're so tired, so just by blocking and getting blocked and everything. You're so tired. You eliminate just about everything you have and whatever you got left. And when you fight the finals, it's just your hands. So when you get to that point, you're intending to use your laser. So when you come to that, then you understand this is my last move. And you have this last move. What have you got? You just know how to get in fast, explode fast. And when he comes in, the same fast key movement. And he comes in on you just when you're just about ready to compete, and you ignite. You know, you have, you're blocking, but you're ready to retire it. Retaliate. And if you can think in those terms and get that, as soon as you come up, it doesn't mean that you to get ready for a day, that you have to go out and win. You've ignited him, you made him wonder what's going on. That alone, you've got little split, 1/20 of a second you have, even though he's made that charge. These are the kind of things that come right down to scientifically really knowing what you're doing with every technique that you throw. And when you use these assets, then you become a master suit, a real killer, right? And that means that in Japanese, it's terminated around it, but the transcription of how that would be the old days, that's the only way they could say that you have existed and you have really come to the point of real knowledge displayed about the true karate is all about. But we don't have to all go to that existence in order to be a lover of karate or sport. But if you go to that extreme, you have a tremendous fulfillment. Joy sparring. It's hard to know. When I was coming up to the ranks, when I became 15, I wanted to spar so bad, and yet I sparred ranking people, sort of hid myself and stuff. You don't want to display your expression, and I think in Japan, when I was with Kitagawa Sensei, Ishiguro, my second man in the organization, we could let out really good. You feel so good about it, you never get tired. But the thing is, you reach that peak so thin, and yet so strong. And when you understand what karate really is, it's a real dangerous sport. But you can't teach. You can't teach students that way until you show them with your body how to get to that point. And the way I've been doing it is fast combination of blocks give you a real setup of key. There's nothing. When you get in, when the opponent comes in hard, you, even when you start to come in, you start doing the combination of real explosive blocks. You could just start doing it. That's absolute mind and body explosion. When you do that, there's nothing to get through. But you have to reach it. And you have to know that it works, and you got to enjoy it. But to that peak, you say, well, you can really hurt each other, which is not true. We should go on I would throw everything that's hard at people's head. Precious. Block is hard. After the fight, you don't even know what it's like. Because some black belt said it's a love of fighting. It isn't. It's that, but it's harder you throw, the more control you have. I know that there's quite a few black belts here that really understand and know it, because I can see it when they're working out. But if you throw something mediocre, testing your opponent, waiting. You're retaliating yourself. You're just cheating yourself. You have not gotten to that dimension where you should have arrived. When you get there, that's when you find out. That's nothing to it. To be in that area. If you don't go in that area, you're just cheating yourself and you will always be a talent. That's the only way I can put it. The thing is you've got to get into that dimension, and when you get into that dimension, there's nothing there. You make a move. There's nothing there to retaliate. Unless you're walking, then you walk in like this. But then, that dimension is dead. But you are going in to do what you're going to do. The techniques. The small point. To mobilize him completely. And even when you get scored, and if you should even react, you're still ready to react. That's as far as you've got to go in. And that's what you've got to practice. Not just go in and score like this, even in the world tournament. One in Japan, with Egypt, a Japanese fellow. He scored and he knew it. I mean, that's not karate. That is not karate. He scored well. Sunni, he had a point. He's got everybody else doing it in the gut, in the region, all over. They think that's corruption. That is garbage that we try to get away from. At no time, a person that knows a technique will do something like that. We have to get away from it. And the only way to get away from it is to start with good black belts, teaching what it really means, is soul techniques, that are deadly blows. You can never throw a deadly blow like that. I don't care how fast your hands are. You're aiming, you're running through, and you're throwing on the side anyway, which, if that person blocked and moved right in, you're done. But they do that, because that's sport karate. So what I taught in Japan is what I'm teaching here, how to really explode going in. No matter what technique comes, afterward, you should be ready to retire. And your hands, double block movement, should be moving as fast as you can. Now, in the future, when I develop people in Canada, we're going to have a competition of members of Japan and all the time. Whether it be in Canada or Japan, I don't know. I'm trying to get a sponsor. So, there's a lot of Japanese that I know to sponsor with. So, I think that part is okay. Take a big episode. I teach him working here, is he working there? And it's got to be working here. Because I've been teaching this for so many years. I've got fifth dance, top ranking, fighting fifth dance in Ontario and Quebec. And here too, with people all coming up at another time. All you people in second, third dance, and you can be right in there. I want to see this. In my teaching something that's going to be adapted, or is it Japanese going to take over?